The Grand Macabre is a story that is sort of about the apocalypse. Death comes and decides, today is the last day, everybody's gonna die, and that's just the way it's gonna be. I'm here to destroy you. I see it as an operatic form of a memento mori. Little symbols about how time is flying quickly, and our lives are grab the meaning of it as quickly as you can. The opera is set in a place, a fictitious place, called Bruegeland. Because I've always deeply loved Bruegel's drawings, I thought maybe what would be wonderful is to make our world about those drawings. It starts out now as a black and white world, which is, I think, also a good metaphor for things being either one way or another. So it's a black and white world made of little drawings that start to move, and they start to become more dimensional. And then we add the dimension of color, and then the dimension of other surprises, such as explosions.
The way we usually start production is by sitting down, Doug and I, and trying to figure out what the vision is. Doug talks to Alan Gilbert, and so everybody's in phase with the vision. The relationship between Alan and Doug is a very privileged relationship. They've known each other for a very long time. They are very close. They know what each of them wants to do artistically. So I think there is a great understanding. So we usually start with storyboarding everything, and that way we create what we call this live animation experience, where everything you see on the giant screen on top of the rest of the show is actually performed live on stage.
We create a moving image over the orchestra that's constantly changing, constantly transforming, almost like a piece of visual alchemy. Here we are in Avery Fisher Hall, and here is where this theater will be situated. This whole piece of apparatus will be on stage next to the conductor, in front of the orchestra. So you'll see us making the film as well as the film itself, as well as the singers. All of those things merge on stage as the opera. So here, for example, are a bed of roses. Okay, so the bed of roses is being filmed here by this video camera. We watch it here on the monitor, which is oval-shaped, so we'll know what it looks like in its final version of a projection. It's going to be projected onto the screen, which will also be oval. That's what people will be watching, because that will be 25 feet across or something like that by the time we get it onto the final screen.
It really feels totally organically synchronized, and I think that's the magic of the show. It's halfway between puppeteering an animated film that would be performed live in front of you if you want. It's a complex process because obviously everything needs to be very prepared. It's a live performance, but many things needs to be thought in advance. There is a lot of very funny things that happen in the process of live animation. The irony is something that is definitely going to get through very well visually on top of the music, obviously, which is wonderful. It's just a delightful, absurd piece of music.
Sometimes it's a very realistic depiction of, to help you understand where the opera is taking place at this moment. And other times it's much more like a description or of a visualization of a feeling that's going on, either in a character or between characters, or just the feeling of the music that's been, we're trying to visualize. Gepopo, when he's going shh, coco, 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 but Gepopo, who takes these words with strange interest and decodes them and starts, it's an oscilloscope that takes the sounds, and the sounds eventually become clear that it's symbolizing the end of the world as well. The people are singing, help us, help us, help us, and they're getting closer and more urgent. And eventually the people turn into binary numbers, because people turn into numbers in bureaucracies, and then they pull away and the people themselves turn into the skull. Everything is just kind of looking rather bad.
What we are doing with when we bring this process of live animation on top of the singers, the orchestra, is the ability to communicate something visually, which is very entertaining and very fun. And that comes from Doug's vision and Doug's world. It's a very humorful world. And I think this is gonna really make this piece very interesting and accessible for the part of the audience that is not used to listen and watch a concert like that.
It's amazing because it's the first time it's been done ever in New York City. It's like the second time maybe it's been ever done in the country. And it's the most performed contemporary opera in the world at the moment, whatever that means. Contemporary opera. This is storytelling music. This is absolutely storytelling, intense storytelling.